Well, good morning, Galilee. It is good to be here this morning. It is a good morning, right? Okay. To make sure, it seemed very quiet after I said that, and I thought, is it a good morning? It is a good morning indeed. Yes, glad to be here. Man, I feel like it's been pretty eventful already, just up to now, you know, between just wonderful musical worship, baptism. We haven't even got to the message yet. But John chapter 7, that's where we're going to be. John chapter 7. And this morning, we're kind of at a turning point in John's gospel. So up to now, we've seen several different events that have happened throughout the life of Jesus, and it hasn't necessarily been one right after another. It's kind of like several years of Jesus' life and ministry have been summed up in just a few chapters. But from chapter 7 onward in John's gospel, what you really see is everything pointing towards the cross from this point forward. You see the hatred toward Jesus just escalated from the religious leaders, and everything is leading to the cross from this point forward. And so that being said, we're going to begin in chapter 7 by looking at the first 13 verses, looking at the where, to kind of see where we are with this story. So starting with verse 1, let's read the first four verses of John chapter 7. John writes, he says, "After this, Jesus went about in Galilee. He would not go about in Judea because the Jews were seeking to kill him. Now the Jews' Feast of Booths was at hand. So his brother said to him, 'Leave here and go to Judea, that your disciples also may see the works you are doing. For no one works in secret if he seeks to be known openly. If you do these things, show yourself to the world.'" Now, the first thing that we see in these first four verses, we see this phrase used, "the Jews." Now, when you see that in John's gospel, I've said this in the past, and I will repeat this again. I've repeated it already a few times throughout our study of John's gospel. You'll see this continue. When John uses the phrase, "the Jews," he's not referring to ethnic Israel. He's not just meaning anyone who ethnically is a part of the Hebrew people, the Jewish race. That's not what he has in view. Rather, John uses that term, "the Jews," to refer to specifically the religious leaders of the Jewish people. Not just anyone who ethnically is a Jew, but the religious leaders of the Jews. That's who he's speaking of. It says that he was going to stay in Galilee, which is north. Judea is in the south, and Jerusalem was in Judea. That's where the temple was. That's where all the festivals, all the feasts would have been done, down here in the south. He's staying up here because of the Jews and them seeking to kill him. Secondly, we see in verse 2, the Jews' Feast of Booths was at hand. This Feast of Booths, or Feast of Tabernacles, it's called, or Feast of Tents, or something. It's several different names or different ways it's been translated. But this is one of the most exciting, most festive times for the Jewish people every year. They loved it. I mean, they were all about this festival because all people would have made every attempt possible to come to the holy city, to come to Jerusalem, so they could celebrate this together. And the best way I could sum it up is this is almost like a nationwide camping trip for a week. It was a week-long celebration. And people all went to the holy city and made these little makeshift tent-like dwellings for their family to stay in. They even had certain codes you had to go by. It couldn't be too nice. Whatever you use for your roof had to be spread so much so that you could still see the stars when you lay down at night in the sky. And the whole purpose of this was to commemorate their ancestors and the years they spent wandering in the wilderness and how God had blessed them and saw them through that. And so they did this every year to commemorate that. But during the day, they would do these festivities where they would sing together and go on these almost like a parade, you could say, walks down to the temple And we'll read about this next week, more specifically, about how they would follow the priest who would bring a pitcher of water. We'll see some of that next week. But it was a really celebratory time, a festive, good, positive, encouraging time for the nation of Israel. That's what's taking place right now. That's kind of the where, that's the setting. And so, that being said, Jesus' brothers, and yes, it says his brothers. I know some that would believe in the perpetual virginity of Mary. That's not possible, according to God and his word. It just isn't. He very clearly states that he had brothers. Also in Matthew 13 and in Mark chapter 3, all state or reference the brothers of Jesus. Some of them even refer to as sisters. We know he had siblings, brothers and sisters. The Bible's clear on that. And his brothers are saying, we want you to come down there in this festive time where everybody's there, show them the signs and wonders that you do. They want to show off their brother to everyone. But then we've got this short little, almost like a parenthetical note in verse 5 that really just captures me. And it's astonishing. Don't run past it. Look at verse 5. For not even his brothers believed in him. The very brothers of Jesus Christ did not believe in him. Just think about that statement for a minute. His brothers witnessed everything about his life. Now, I grew up with two brothers, one 2 years older than myself, one 2 years younger. And of course, we always laugh and joke about who the good kid was and who always got in trouble. I'll let y'all figure that out. But I always looked at my older brother and I thought, man, he could do no wrong. He's just the perfect child. He never gets in trouble like I do. I don't understand. We probably all think that to some degree. If you have siblings, you're either that perfect child or it's your sibling. But here, this is something on a whole nother level. I mean, you're talking about someone who is completely sinless with sinners. I think there's no way you couldn't have noticed and it been blatantly obvious there is something different about Jesus. Something vastly different about Jesus. Zero sin at all. I can look at a sinner who's just pretty well behaved and it stands out to me. Now imagine someone who's completely sinless and yet his very own brothers did not believe in him. Did not believe in him. I think this is a good teaching point for all of us. Proximity to Jesus does not and will not save you. It won't. I mean, think about how this plays out in a very practical manner. You've got the very brothers of Jesus living with him, sleeping in the same place and eating breakfast and lunch and dinner and working and playing together. You can't get closer to Christ. And yet they did not believe in him. And I think about us kind of in our context, to put it, like I said, in very practical terms. You can't just be around Christian people and expect to be saved eternally. It doesn't happen that way. Now, are there common benefits or common graces that we can experience? Yes, there are. And to be biblical, 1 Corinthians chapter 7, starting in verse 14, Paul says this, the unbelieving husband will be sanctified or made holy by his believing wife. And the unbelieving wife can be made holy by the believing husband. But in that context, I think it's very clear what Paul is stating is the importance of marriage and that unity. But just because you may experience some good common graces from God by virtue of who you're married to, that will not save you eternally. Look, it's no different than, just think of the church as a whole. You may be an unbeliever. You have not repented of your sins. You have not trusted Christ. You do not believe in Christ. You're like one of Jesus' brothers. You can come here every single Sunday and join us. You can come on Wednesday nights and eat a good meal. You can go to men's and women's events. You can be an active part of this fellowship, and you're going to experience some pretty good blessings. You're going to be set apart. That's what it means to be made holy or sanctified, to be set apart. You're going to be set apart here because you're going to experience good fellowship. People are going to call and check on you when something happens. People are going to give you encouragements. You get all the benefits of being here, but that does not and will not save you. Proximity to Christ does not save. Nothing but the blood of Christ saves. Nothing but the blood of Christ will save you. He goes on in verse 6. It says, Jesus said to them, "My time has not yet come, but your time is always here. The world cannot hate you, but it hates me because I testify about it that its works are evil. You go up to the feast. I am not going up to this feast, for my time has not yet fully come." After saying this, he remained in Galilee. One of the things I think we could point out there is that Jesus operates on his own time as he fulfills the will of God the Father. His brothers wanted him to do according to their plans, but Jesus says no. Jesus doesn't conform to their plans or to your plans or to my plans, but he follows the will of God the Father, and that's what he's here to do. We read that last week in chapter 6. He made it abundantly clear. I am here to do the will of my Father. It's the whole point in him being here. His brothers wanted him to do according to their plans and their will, but it does not work that way. We must conform our will to Christ, not expect him to conform to our will or our comfort. So I think we see this often today. We kind of talked about this in our Sunday school class as we're going through biblical apologetics. One of the things you'll see a lot of people do is try and remake or reshape or reform Jesus into our own image and likeness. The Jesus of Scripture is a little bit too tough. There are things that make me uncomfortable about him, so I'm just going to remake him in a little nicer version that I'm more comfortable with, and that's what I'll present or believe in. That's what I want. But that Jesus cannot save. Only the Jesus of the Bible can save. If you find yourself remaking Jesus into some kind of an image or something that you like better, that's more akin to you and not Scripture, we have a name for that. It's called idolatry. You can call it what you want to call it. You can call him Jesus all you want. You cannot remake Jesus into your own image or conform him to your will. And the second thing we see in that passage is what he says in verse 7. The world cannot hate you, but it hates me. And then he gives you the reason, because, there's that word, this is why the world hates him. I testify about it that its works are evil. The Jews, the religious leaders, the world, they hated Jesus because he testified that their works are evil. John, the author, he's established in John's gospel that Jesus is the light of the world. That's why I made that the subheading for this sermon series. That's who he is. Light provides a way, a means that we can know and understand the truth of the gospel, and that he is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through him. John 14:6, we know that he's the light of the world. But you know what else light does? It exposes what's been in darkness. The world doesn't like that. We don't, in our own selves, want to be exposed and laid bare before a holy God with all of our sin. We don't like that. The world fights against that. And that's why it says they hate me, because I'm exposing that darkness and the need for the gospel. Which is one of the reasons they try to remake Jesus into something that's not so exposing, that doesn't kind of lay them open so much. Let me remake Jesus a little nicer and kinder that doesn't have all these demands for my life. Let me follow that Jesus. Like I said, that Jesus cannot and will not save. Verse 10 tells us, it says, but after his brothers had gone up to the feast, then he also went up, not publicly, but in private. Now, some commentators have read verse 10 and said, aha, it's a contradiction in God's word. Because he just had stated in chapter 7, I'm not going up to this feast. And now in verse 10, he's saying, then he went up there. He went to the feast. Why? How do we make sense out of this? Well, two things that I think are important to note. One, I think the important thing is not do you ever go or not go, but the timing of it. Keep in mind, that's what he kept mentioning earlier. At the beginning of the feast is starting. He's not going. It's not time yet. And he goes later. As we'll see in a few verses, it's the middle of the feast when he does go. So he's operating on God's time, not their time. I don't think we should read that so hard as to say he's never going to the feast, but he's not going now. And then secondly, the manner with which he went, I think, is where he's making a distinction. From what we read at the very beginning, why did the brothers want him to go to the feast? To show him to everybody. I want everyone to see. Go make yourself publicly known on display for everybody. Go raise some paralyzed people. Do some of these amazing miracles. That way everyone can see and be astounded at what you're doing. And Jesus is saying no. How does he go up? Not publicly, but in private. And so I think that's what Jesus is doing. He's saying, wait, and I'll go later, and I'm going to go in private, not publicly, to start things. He goes on with the where in verse 11. It says, the Jews were looking for him at the feast and saying, where is he? And there was much muttering about him among the people. While some said, he is a good man, others said, no, he is leading the people astray. Yet for fear of the Jews, no one spoke openly of him. Verse 12 tells us that some of these people claimed, he's a good man. That's who Jesus is. And he is a good man. But I like the argument from C.S. Lewis years ago. C.S. Lewis, talking about the claim that he's a good man, disagreed with that. And some of us may think, if you're not familiar with hearing this before, would say, well, what do you mean you disagree that Jesus is a good man? Clearly, we're good Christians. We do believe he's a good man. The argument that C.S. Lewis had is that doesn't say enough. It falls woefully short of who Jesus truly is. You can't merely say the Lord of glory is a good man. Your neighbor may be a good man. He intends well, likes to help out here and there. You can't say Jesus, the Son of God, is just simply a good man. Lewis's argument was that many people will claim when the question of who is Jesus, they will say, well, he's a good man or he was a good teacher. That's what he was. You'll hear that commonly about people who aren't followers of Christ. They'll kind of give like a little nod to Jesus. I mean, we got the golden rule. He had some good moral principles. He's a good man, good teacher. But Lewis's arguments went kind of like this. He said, no, because there are some hard things that Jesus taught and said. Right? You must hate your family. You must drop everything and follow me. He said he was the only way, not a way, the truth and the life, the. He said, if you do not eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, that was just last week we covered that, you have no life in you, none. Good teachers don't make those kinds of bold claims where he says, I and the Father am one, or from John chapter 6, ego I me. I am the bread of life, making himself divine, one with God the Father. Good teachers don't claim to be God. They just simply give you some good, wise ideas. That's what good teachers do. Jesus made bold claims. Lewis's argument, he said this, you have to do one of three things. You have to either say that he's a liar. He's not God the Son. Jesus can't be who he truly said he is. I don't believe it. I reject it. I mean, that's what they said in the text, right? Some of them said that he's a good man, and then the other said, no, he's deceiving. He's leading the people astray. He's a liar. So you either say that Jesus is a liar, or you may say he's not intentionally lying. He's crazy. He's just lost his mind. He says some good things, but some crazy things. But it's not because he's trying to mislead people. He's just crazy. He's a lunatic. That's who Jesus is. A crazy person, because that's the only people who claim to be God. Or you have a third option. What Lewis argues, you have to say he's either a liar, a lunatic, or he's Lord. He's not simply a good teacher. He's a liar, he's a lunatic, or he's Lord. One of the three, you have to decide who is Christ. Next, we see the wonder in this text. Look at verse 14. It says, about the middle of the feast, Jesus went up into the temple and began teaching. So now we see that this verse kind of marks the time that he openly began to make himself a little more public there with going into the temple and teaching. The Jews therefore marveled, saying, how is it that this man has learning when he has never studied? So Jesus answered them, my teaching is not mine, but his who sent me. If anyone's will is to do God's will, he will know whether the teaching is from God or whether I'm speaking on my own authority. The one who speaks on his own authority seeks his own glory, but the one who seeks the glory of him who sent him is true, and in him there is no falsehood. Notice that Jesus refutes the claim that they had just made about him being a liar by appealing to his submission to God the Father. I'm not lying, I'm submitting to God the Father. That's where my teaching comes from. Go, look, listen. And also notice what verse 15 says. They marveled at Jesus' teaching there in the temple. They marveled at it. They simply could not understand how this carpenter's son from a nothing, hole-in-the-wall, small town like Nazareth could come into the temple in the holy city and speak with such profound clarity and boldness and authority. I mean, they couldn't understand how that could possibly happen. But keep in mind, Jesus was obediently serving God the Father, obeying God the Father according to the text. And that's what God uses for his glory, people who are obedient to him. You see, the normal thing for that time would have been for a rabbi to go stand up at the temple and teach. And what they would have done, these would have been people who were highly educated in the law. Highly educated, very well read in all the rabbis who had gone before them. And reading the Talmud and all these things, they would have been really educated. And they would have stood up, they would have read from the law, they would have gave some kind of a brief explanation. And the majority of what they spoke, their sermons, I guess you would call it, was just quoting from rabbis throughout Jewish tradition. And what they had said and shared about the law of God. That's what it kind of would have looked like. Well, if you're going to stand up somewhere for a long period of time and just quote and quote and quote and reference other people, you have to be pretty well read. You have to know your stuff pretty well. That's what would have been normal. And then here comes Jesus, a carpenter's son from a podunk town like Nazareth, who shows up, no education, nothing. But because he obediently follows the Father, he stands up and he starts teaching, and people marvel. They're shocked at what Jesus shares with them. Now listen, this gives me encouragement as well as pause. It gives me encouragement as well as pause when I think about who and how God uses people. And I think we're probably guilty many times of thinking, man, if God would call so-and-so, he could really think of how he could use that person because they're so smart, they're so sharp, they're so wise. That's who God could use. But God uses people who are obedient to him, not people who maybe meet some certain criteria from a worldly standard. I want to go to 1 Corinthians just to further kind of make this point, because I think this is something we need to think through. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, the Apostle Paul speaks to this kind of same thing, where when you think of using something that's not from a worldly standpoint very impressive, look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, starting in verse 26. Paul writes, he says, "For consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth." Now, verse 26 there, "Not many of you were of noble birth." I want you to see a few things in there. He gives us three things in that verse. I like to share this. Don't feel like you have to do it. I've got three things underlined in that verse because there's three things that God is specifically saying that he's not looking for. In other words, I do not want these things. I'm not looking for wise, powerful, or noble. God's saying, I don't need that. I don't want that. It's not what I'm looking for. It's not what I'm looking for. I take comfort in that. I don't know about you. I do not come from nobility, to much of your shock. That's a joke. I don't come from nobility, y'all. I'm not powerful. I'm constantly reminded of how unwise I am. I make foolish decisions all the time. Just like as simple as last night, I fixed myself a good old meal that my wife had cooked and then left everything sitting there all night long. And this morning she woke up and said, "You never put anything in the refrigerator." Whoops. Every week I sit down and do sermon prep and I read and study other people and I think of what other people have written and I think, man, how insightful and wise. I'm not wise. I'm not powerful. I'm not from nobility. That should encourage us. But look at what he does use, verse 27. "But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are." Notice a couple things. One, he says three different times, God chose. It doesn't say God was left with only this option. It doesn't say God had to use whatever was available and it just so happened it was a carpenter's son. No, no, no. God intentionally designed and made a conscious decision, here's what I am going to use for my glory and to further my kingdom. And again, he lists out several things if you want to underline. Look at it. What does he want to use? We saw what he doesn't want in 26. He doesn't want wise, powerful, or noble people. Instead, God chose foolish, weak, low, despised, and things that are not. God made a decision, this is what I'm going to use for my glory. Again, I'm not trying to be Mr. Humility, but I take comfort in that. Because I think, that's me. Look, you know my story. I don't have any degrees. I don't have anything. I'm a welder / HVAC guy with a high school diploma, and that's it. And halfway through my adult life, the Lord called me into ministry. And I struggle sometimes with what I've called imposter syndrome. I'm pretending to be something that I'm really not because I don't fit the stereotypical model of it. But then I read this text and I get encouragement because I think this is what God wants to use. I want people who are foolish, weak, low, despised, and are not. But then where it cuts at me and causes a bit of fear is that it's all based on obediently and humbly following Christ. Jesus was obedient to the Father. That's why he was used. You may be low and not of nobility and all those things, but if pride creeps in, or if you're not truly obediently following after God, that's not who and how he's going to use you. You have to be willing to humbly obey Christ. It all depends on that. How do I know that? Look at verse 29. Let's finish this. He says, so that, I've got those circled in a different color because that is a crucial part. Those two little words, so that in verse 29, that's giving the whole reason that he gave you verse 26 and 27. I don't want these things. I do want these things. Why? So that no human being might boast in the presence of God. Listen, you could think of it as simple as this. You may help me do something, whatever task I need. There have been several church members who have helped me out with things in the past. And I will look at you and say, thank you for helping or doing whatever you're doing. And they say, well, you're welcome. Or myself. I mean, I went and had to look at someone's air conditioner this week just to try and help out. And they said, thank you. And I said, you're welcome. I've got the know-how and the tools. I've got the ability. And I was willing to help you. You're welcome. But how dare any of us ever stand before a holy God and say, you're welcome, God? Never should we have that mindset or attitude. That's not who God uses for his glory. The whole purpose in him choosing to use these things is so that no human being may boast. None of us can stand and say, you're welcome, God. You should feel blessed by God that he uses us. Look, we've had discussions the last few weeks about this service. It's full. And we just dumped out 30 kids out of here. You put 30 more people in here, it's really full. Where do we put people? We're out of space. Week after week, we keep having membership and baptism. How awesome is that? But how dare any of us boast? I don't care if it's men's ministry and who's leading that, or women's, or who's up here, who serves as an elder, or who's leading our music. I don't care what church. Our ultimate prayer, I've had times where I've caught myself thinking, God, please do an awesome work here at Galilee. I would love to see this place so full we have to move by force. We don't have anywhere else to put people, and we just grow and keep doing baptisms and membership every single week. And I pray, God, use us, bless Galilee. And I'm blessed to be a pastor of this church, so I think, yes, bless this church. But I'm instantly convicted, and I think, wait a minute, I need to dial it back. God, further your kingdom. I had to be Galilee. Use them at Zohar Baptist. Use them in Zachary, in Central. The church right here. God, just further your kingdom. Whomever, however. I don't want anyone to have any reason to boast. So back in John 7, they're amazed. They marvel at the teaching of Jesus, but they do so because he's obediently doing the will of his Father. And lastly, we see the who in verse 19 following. He says, has not Moses given you the law, yet none of you keeps the law? Why do you seek to kill me? The crowd answered, you have a demon. Who is seeking to kill you? Jesus answered them, I did one work and you all marvel at it. Moses gave you circumcision, not that it is from Moses, but from the fathers. And you circumcise a man on the Sabbath. If on the Sabbath the man receives circumcision so that the law of Moses may not be broken, are you angry with me because on the Sabbath I made a man's whole body well? Here we see Jesus reasoning from lesser to greater through the law. If that little passage confused any of you, what we've seen through chapter 5 and chapter 6 leading up to chapter 7 is repeated reference to Moses and the law. They love Moses. I've said before he was kind of like the George Washington of this country. That's who Moses was to the Jews. They loved him, our forefather. They go back to him over and over and over again. And the law that came through Moses. And Jesus reasoning with them from that, he says, what you're essentially doing is saying, you broke the law of Moses, therefore we're going to break the law of Moses to punish you for breaking the law of Moses. Does that make sense? That's the simplest way I could put it in the text. How dare you break the law of Moses, therefore I'm going to break the law of Moses and punish you for breaking the law of Moses. That doesn't even make logical sense. Jesus is pointing out their error, but then he goes even a step further with it. They, first off, tell him, what are you talking about? No one's here to kill you. You have a demon. You know what this is? This is gaslighting at its finest. That's what it is. We're not trying to kill you. What are you talking about? Well, you're talking to God the Son, who knows what's on the hearts of all of men. Clearly, you're trying to kill him. He's calling you out in your sin. Remember, he's the light of the world. We know something about gaslighting, do we not? And Jesus moves the argument to circumcision. He said, I did one work and you all marvel at it. Well, in verse 21, do you know what that work is? This is a reference back to chapter 5. So to refresh your memory, because that was a couple months ago. In chapter 5 of John's Gospel, at the very beginning, you see a story of a man who had been an invalid. Couldn't move or walk, we assume quadriplegic, maybe paraplegic, we don't know, but an invalid for 38 years. 38 years. He had no muscle, no tissue on him. Undoubtedly, he's there next to the pool, and he wants to get put in the pool because the tradition said if you're the first one to get put in it, when the waters are stirred, you'll be healed. And so he goes, and he's there, and he's like, no one will put me in a pool. I can't physically get in the pool, and so I'm not healed. I've been here for 38 years like this. And Jesus says, pick up your bed and walk. You're healed. The man is miraculously healed just like that. But it took place on the Sabbath. And you are not to do work on the Sabbath. Therefore, the Jews hated him. Who healed you? Who told you, pick up your bed and walk? Why would they do that on the Sabbath? You can't do that. That's what he's referring to. So he says here, I did one work and you marvel at it. And he says in verse 22, Moses gave you circumcision. And here's another one of those, I don't know, I think it's a shot from Jesus to them. Because he adds in there, not that it's from Moses, but from the fathers. You harp on Moses all the time. This came way before Moses was even around. This is from our Moses' fathers. It says, and you circumcise a man on the Sabbath. So here was the situation of that day. The law states you don't work on the Sabbath. Don't do it. However, you know what else the law stated? All Jewish boys were to be circumcised on the eighth day. Well, guess what happens if you had your child. If a woman delivered a baby 8 days before the Sabbath, the eighth day was the Sabbath. What do? Do you not work on the Sabbath, or do you go through a circumcision on the Sabbath? Which one do you obey? And what they chose to do is said, no, you have to circumcise that child on the eighth day. Even today, all Jewish babies, you don't do it on day 7, you don't do it on day 9. It is day 8 to this day that they practice that. And so they made provision to carry out circumcision on the eighth day. And Jesus is saying, if on the Sabbath a man receives circumcision, in verse 23, so that the law of Moses may not be broken, are you angry with me? Because on the Sabbath I made a man's whole body well? You mutilate one member of a man's body on the Sabbath and you think it's fine. I bring healness and completely restore an entire man's body on the Sabbath. And now you want to kill me for it? Do you not see how in error you are? And in verse 24, he says, do not judge by appearances, but judge with right judgment. Many would say, for the longest time, that the most popular verse in all of Scripture is John 3:16. We all know that verse. For God so loved the world, you could probably all finish it. But many have argued that that verse has been surpassed by another verse as the most well-known verse in all of Scripture. And that's Matthew 7:1. And some of you may not know Matthew 7:1 just by its reference. But you'll know it as soon as I start saying it. Judge not, lest you be judged. You don't have to be a believer. I mean, I've quoted what R.C. Sproul used to say, every pagan in America knows one Bible verse and one Bible verse alone. Judge not, lest you be judged. The second you try to do just what Jesus did, expose sin or confront something, the second you do anything, people are super quick. Bible says, don't you judge. You cannot judge me. First off, I think that fails on just a plain logical level. Anyone who's ever hired a babysitter for your kids, did you judge? I mean, did you hire the old biker guy from down the road? Or did you hire the little 14-year-old cheerleader that lives next door to come babysit your kids? You know, you're going to make some judgments in life. That's what we're going to do. I hope you do. We all do. But even spiritually speaking, we have to make judgments. I have to make judgments. I look out and I say, what fruit is in their life? Is this person a believer? You know what? The Bible is full of reasons or evidences to know if someone is a believer. You will have love for one another. You will bear fruit. You will spend time in prayer. He gives us all sorts of reasons how you can tell if someone's a true believer. Why? We need to know for our own assurance, one. Two, for even just pastoral reasons. I need to know if this is truly a believer and I see sin in their life, I need to go to them in a way that I can confront that sin to try and see them restored and live a godly life. It's not that I'm trying to condemn them to hell. We all know Matthew 7:1. You know what we don't know? Matthew 7:2. Matthew 7:3, Matthew 7:4, and 5 and 6, where he tells you, get the log out of your own eye before you go get the speck out of their eye. He doesn't say never get a speck out of someone's eye. He just simply says you deal with the sin that you have first and foremost. Make sure you're right with God. Then you go try and correct for good reasons. And you're not condemning someone to hell. I would sure hope that we all try and help each other in the Christian life. If you see me stumbling and failing, I would hope someone would confront me with it. Man, Brian, I think you're struggling in this area. You're way too short of temper. You're lashing out at someone. You sure seem jealous of this individual or that church. Why are you doing this? Jesus here tells them not to not judge, but he tells them in verse 24 in John's gospel, do not judge by appearances, but judge with right judgment. You need to judge with right judgment. Look, I want to kind of wrap up by going through something we mentioned earlier. Part of the thing, that one of the things we have to do is make a right judgment on who Jesus is. I really want you to think through this in a serious way, because every single one of us is going to stand before our Maker one day and have to give an account. What do you believe about Jesus? And to go back to an earlier point, you can't simply say he's a good man. He's a liar, he's a lunatic, or he's Lord. What is he? What do you believe that he is? Look, even the very brothers of Christ did not believe in him. They didn't believe in him. Luckily, they did later. But at this time, they were not even believers. When I think of this church, and one of the things that I've thought about with this text is just how some of us could be so close in proximity to Christ and not judge rightly and see Christ for who he truly is. I would never want that for anyone here. And let me speak in a real practical way, because I have been there myself years ago. Husbands, hear me out. You cannot and will not be saved due to your wife's faith. It's not going to happen. I know many husbands who will go to church to appease their wife into thinking, I married a good man. He comes to church with me. He'll even put his arm around me. It will not save you. You have to have your own faith in Christ. Proximity to Jesus does not save. And the same is true the other way. Wives, you can't simply come to church to look like a good Christian mother, to set a good example for your kids. Yes, I hope you do set a good example. Yes, I hope you strive to to live a life that exemplifies a good Christian mother. I hope those things. But you can't simply do that to ease your conscience or something. You're not saved by that. You're only saved by the blood of Jesus. That's it. Kids, parents, no matter which route we go with this, you are not saved simply by proximity, simply by coming to make your parents happy. Look, my dad, my mom, they're very involved at the church. Let me go so they'll get off my back. I'm good. I'm doing a good thing. You have to own your faith. You have to decide. You have to judge with right judgment. Who is Jesus? Is he truly Lord? Is he Lord? And if he is, then you better repent of your sins and trust him fully for salvation. Otherwise, you will die apart from Christ and spend eternity away from him. Your faith has to be your own. Your faith has to be your own. Do not judge by appearances, but judge with right judgment. Who is Jesus to you, and have you truly trusted him on an individual level? Let's close in prayer, and we'll have a time of response.